You have been the voice, the public statement. You have had so much coverage. You have been had the microphone stuck under your face to speak on behalf, and you have embodied this thing that 1 in 1,500 to 2,000 people in the world are born with, and yet nobody knows about. So how is that for you?
Well, it's a task that I didn't take on easily. People are probably really surprised to know that for most of my life I was a very shy person, that standing on a stage was not something that I did by design, but my life before that, as an intersex person, I had worked for civil defence. And one of them, and I was in a very senior position, so I had many training that role. So paradoxically, I had learned awkwardly to stand professionally in front of the camera. But in doing my own work and understanding the damage that had been done, and I mean the fact that I was in my early 40s, I'd lived really for 40 years with suicidal ideation. And as I did some very complex therapy work, I came to the point where I understood that what had done the damage wasn't the surgery, that was very damaging. What had done the damage was the lies and the secrets and the not talking about it. By then, with my parents had gone, and again, as part of that therapeutic journey, I came to the realization I couldn't change the past, but I damn well could change the future. So the first thing was for me to find a comfortable place with the body and a reality that I was not only uncomfortable, but I had no relationship with my body. And then my original training, interesting how life folds together. I'm a teacher. So I thought, I actually know. And then I started thinking about my family. And my dad came from a family of naturally gifted storytellers, and that's in my bones. And so I made the decision that there would be no more silence, no more lying, that I would be up, and I could do that initially. And that framework of the media. And the person who altered that story for me is in the room. So it's wonderful to acknowledge you, yes. When you approach me to do a piece of work with you and assume nothing, and I thought, yeah, I don't have to do that. I don't have to do this. I can do the help. I can talk without emotion and heart. And that profound day that I spent with you doing the photographs is what joined the head and the heart together. And we talked last night about transformative moments. That was and making that decision and making that commitment. No, I've gone over and over, and it's just got stronger and stronger. And the reason is that we need to be able to do some kind of work at the moment. And I was in America immediately after 9/11, weirdly, and standing in a corralled area inside an airport, guarded by machine gun toting young people, people so young, and thinking about who I was standing with. And I was standing with people who mostly were not white, people who were old, people who were young. And when I really thought about it, we were a group of marginalized people who had been identified as terrorists. And I realized this issue is planetary. It's, we have to work out a different way to do it. Otherwise, planetary is ending.
Yeah. And in that movie, you talk about your tribe. Your tribe is so scattered.
It's very scattered. It's also not particularly cohesive. It's a tribe that's blood and linkage and power comes out of trauma.
Yeah. So what the filmmakers wanted to do in a way was to take you with them to meet your tribe and to narrate and link their stories. How did that feel?
That sounds very organized. As if, you know, that's what happened before. No, the making of that film was an organic process. And in fact, the part that I would even front and narrate the film was not clear when we left New Zealand. So in a very Kiwi way, it was one cameraman, John, who did everything else on that.
It was still, though, a leap of trust, you taking the cameraman and the filmmakers to your people.
It was. I already had a history of working with John here, so we had made the Māori story documentary probably 6 or 7 years previously, so I don't think I can trust this man. Grant, I didn't know at all, and our initial relationship together was very rocky. So, it's a process, and I reflected during the trip and then later, so here I was traveling around mostly America with 2 cis hip guys. And yet it worked. And it worked because we all held professional responsibility, and they are both of them very gifted documentary makers and came to respect my role. And also, we came back with 55 hours.
Just reflect on that, everybody. 55 hours to bring down to 70 minutes.
Yeah, and the first cut that we did, because it was a contract for New Zealand Army, the first cut that John did, the TV one, I think it's been the screen, I hated it. But by then they'd run out of money. There wasn't actually enough money for a second edit. So Grant McHood cut the version that you see now in his own time over nearly a year. So he just quite easily went back in his own time.
Marie, can you just tell everyone the story of the one day that you did do the narration behind the vision? Because I like the story.
We ran out of money, so there was no time for a nice sound studio. So it was done in Grant's lovely house, and the kids went off to school, and he raised them and took the mattresses off their beds and all the other beds and stacked them, and that was the soundproofing and loud. He had a reasonably good quality sound system, so he had that. But the day that we did it, there was a bank robbery not very far away. And the police helicopter was in a bit. It was on about a 10-minute sequence. So out of that, we would get about 3.5 minutes where it was quiet enough to do it. So that whole narration took all day. And it was
the day made up of 3.5 minutes.
Yeah, bites. Yeah, it was interesting because I am not a trained narrator, and so Grant was coaching. He had an idea of what he wanted to be, and it needs to be a bit cooler, or can you make it more hot, or and we did it. A profound experience.
And you must, when you first saw it for the first time, all done together, you must have been absolutely thrilled with how it was linked together.
No. For a long time, every time I saw it, I could only see the things that were wrong.
Right.
That's a lot of who I am as a person. But I've now seen it hundreds, not hundreds of thousands of times. And I can see the extraordinary beauty of it and the what Grant did, how he got to do the best, the power of it.
Yeah. Very good. So, how long ago was it made now? Do you remember? It's not a new film.
No, it's not that. It's...
Oh, I know. Well, I know exactly when we filmed it. Was the election of Barack Obama was during the campaign. So what's that? Yeah, and it was another 3.5 years before we came back to the no final version. And the original version came out for TV, and then a friend of mine and wife said this needs to be seen by more people. So I would have only ever had one screening on television, and she put the money up so that it could be re-edited for the silver screen. So I would like to honour Joy Lindico, because she's from the making of it to become an international documentary.
And it's travelled all over, hasn't it?
Still, it's
won awards. So do you think it's not a new film of a stage that, but do you think it's still relevant to the experience of being an intersex person in Aotearoa?
That film is relevant to the world. I wish I could sit here and say that the issue was over, and it isn't. And so what it's seen in that film is still absolutely current today.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And since that film was made, how many countries have made it illegal to operate on babies? And we can count on two hands?
We have some legislation in Malta. And there's legislation in Argentina. We haven't got enough time as well, right? So, if that's an effective route to go down, I'm not totally sure. I've always felt if we made surgery illegal, probably what would happen is wealthy people would just take their children to countries where they can still have surgery. But what we need to change is that fundamental terror in desiring parents that would lead them to engage in the medical process. And so we don't need laws to change, we need to change the upping light around parents so that parents can feel comfortable to go, oh my God, I've got this fabulous child who needs me to love them, and then support that child as they grow up.
You've been having conversations with medical people, but haven't you?
Hard,
big conversation. Yeah. How's it going?
And changing that medical model is, well, so far we haven't been successful, and we continue to talk.
Yeah. I'd like to go back to the film now, and we'll show another clip.